Welcome to the Download Youth Ministry Web Show. My name is Josh. I am the host of the web show, and today I'm running the show solo, except I have a very special guest. How are you?
I'm great. I'm really glad to be here, Josh. Thank you very
We're
much.
We're stoked to have you here. Introduce yourself to the gathering
great.
Here.
My name is Rich Peluso. I'm the Senior Vice President of Affirm Films, which is a film studio that's owned and operated by Sony Pictures.
That is awesome. Tell us some of the films that you have, that Affirm in particular has released in the past.
Sure. Hopefully you guys have seen Soul Surfer, Heaven is for Real. The Remaining was our horror movie that we worked on.
Scare people into heaven. That's
scare
what
people,
I say.
Yes, or scare the hell out of them.
Yes, there
say.
It is.
And then, of course, War Room is our latest big
Absolutely.
Theatrical hit.
That was huge, by the
it
way.
Was. It was. It worldwide, over $71 million on this little picture. So
that is incredible.
Heaven is for Real, Courageous, all kinds of movies. So,
that's really cool. And well, obviously, we're here to talk about the brand new film that comes out really soon. The movie is called Risen.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very excited about the film. I actually was invited up to Sony with you to see the film a few weeks ago, and it was terrific. So spoiler alert, it's great. All right, there you go. Tell us just a little bit about the journey to this story. Why this story? Why this movie? And then we're actually going to let everybody see a little clip of it.
Great. I mean, Risen is the story of a Roman military general. His title is Tribune, and he's essentially the general of the field in Judea. And it really is his journey as this really merchant of death, you know, a leader of the Roman army who intersects with Jesus, or as Yeshua, as we call him in his Hebrew name in the film. And so it's a story of Christ, but in a really kind of a different perspective. It's through the eyes of this Roman military tribune. It's through the eyes of a skeptic and a non-believer. So it kind of turns the story on its head in many ways. So it's a great experience.
Yeah. And now is it a true story? Tell us a little bit about that.
Sure. It is really the intersection of scripture and historical fiction, right? So, you know, in scripture, when Jesus is on the road and meets up with Cleopas, that's where we are in scripture. But certainly some miles away in Jerusalem, Caiaphas and Pilate are wondering where the body is, right?
Right.
He rose from the dead that day. The tomb is empty. When scripture talks about the Roman soldiers that were guarding the tomb, of course, you know, it's written from the perspective of those who witnessed the events. Well, when those Roman guards left, they went somewhere and they talked to somebody.
I love it.
So, right, so that's where the historical fiction intersects. Is we cover this story, you know, the story within the scripture, but then we also cover the other side.
Yeah,
of the story.
I mean, I was absolutely loving the story because every once in a while I'd be like, oh, that part is in the Bible, and now I'm having this whole new perspective of what the centurion thought, or what his commanding officer would have thought, or even the people gathered at the cross. Like, it was just fascinating to go, I know these events from the Bible are true, and what a fantastic story kind of woven into those events.
Certainly, yes.
Very, very cool. Well, let's watch a clip from the movie Risen. Check this out.
Vivian. Pilate summons you.
I'm yet sticky with filth.
No matter. There's more trouble.
What's happened?
Passover.
Every hothead and holy fool in Judea was here stirring the pot. Some ascetic, one of following by making waves to the Sanhedrin, decided to put him down. Sent a lathered mob here screaming for his blood because he claims to be their messiah. I had to crucify him. Don't give me that look. I've had enough already. I had a situation, Tribune, something you don't seem to understand. Soon the Emperor arrives here and he expects to find order. Order!
What does he want of me, Prefect?
Take control out there and finish things. This has gone on long enough. And do this Nazarene a small mercy. Break his legs.
All right, very cool. That's awesome. Little glimpse into the film comes out really soon. How neat. Tell me really quick, you share your favorite part of the film. Like, what's the moment, without being too much of a spoiler?
Sure.
And then I'll tell you mine, if that's okay.
Of course. My favorite part of the film is going to be a part that you probably don't even remember. It is my favorite because it's full of subtext. There's not a piece of dialogue spoken. And it is when Clavius, you know, Clavius is—he's a Roman soldier. He's an officer. He lives death every day, but he is religious as well. He is religious in the sense of living in the world of the pagan world of the Roman gods.
Right.
And his god is Mars that he ascribes his faith to. And there's a scene in the movie, which is kind of a throwaway scene, but I insisted we keep it, is after Clavius intersects with several of the disciples, and he kind of sees their hope and their joy, proclaiming that this Messiah has risen, even though there's no proof of that from Clavius's viewpoint.
Sure,
he's
right.
Not seen the Messiah. There's a scene where he's frustrated because he cannot get the clues he needs to figure out what happened, and he's walking back to his barracks, and he sees his little altar to Mars, and he stops, and he stares at this dead, lifeless metal god, and it just holds on him for about 4 or 5 seconds, and what you see in this character is the realization that he's interacting with all these people who have a living god who is energizing and inspiring them, and this dead god who he's never seen alive, he's never spoken to, that's the only world that he knows, and it's a critical point in his
so
faith
powerful.
Journey. So that's my favorite part.
I love it. It's I do remember that sequence very vividly. It says so much without a word being spoken.
Right.
And you're just looking at that going, I get it. Yep. I get what's going on in his head right now. That's beautiful. I think my favorite part of the film, there are many. It is beautifully shot. Mm. It is a fantastic film. Yeah, we can talk about Christian films and all that business later, I suppose, right? But it is beautiful. A-list actors, maybe we can bring that up later. But I love most films that cover the crucifixion, the story in Jesus and disciples, and then the very end of the film is Jesus is crucified.
Right, right.
And what just threw me for a loop is we start off, boom, Jesus, the beginning of the film is the crucifixion. I realize that's a little bit of a spoiler, but I love it. It's terrific because you know that, oh, wow, this isn't the end. This is the beginning of our story.
I
wonder what happens next.
Yeah. I mean, that was purposeful. You know, where, like you said, I mean, where most films about the life of Christ end at the crucifixion, risen begins the crucifixion.
Absolutely.
And that really kicks off what we describe as the greatest manhunt in human history.
Hmm.
So, you know, while Scripture talks about the hundreds of people that witnessed Christ alive after the resurrection, you know, there was a period of time where he rose and, you know, the rumor was out that he rose, but not many people had seen him, you know.
Right.
And in those critical hours after the resurrection, you had this political religious machine of Rome and Judea and the Sanhedrin
Yes.
all just turned on their heads because they their whole goal was to maintain peace, to suppress these uprisings in Jerusalem and Judea. And the one simple thing they had to do, no matter whether you believe in Jesus or not,
right,
whether you believe he rose or not, there's really some facts that you cannot argue with. The Romans and the religious leaders of the time wanted that man dead and in the tomb. They posted guards, and it was empty.
Right.
So the best of the Roman military, the strongest army in the world, and they can't keep one man in a tomb. That's a pretty powerful story.
Yeah, that's quite a statement right there too.
Right.
Yeah, I love it. Well, it's beautifully shot. There are so many poignant moments. I feel like you're kind of filling in the gap of what the Bible doesn't cover with this fictional story. Incredibly well done. Let's actually watch another clip of the film right here. Check this out.
Great.
What sky is this? Last hour the sun was shining.
Whoa! Easy! Whoa!
Poseidon's unhappy.
Some god is.
I hate it when they scream. I hate it. It could last for days at one.
Get back now!
Centurion, how goes this?
A strange day, Tribune.
It was just a tremor.
That? And too much dark in the air. But this king, something's wrong. The mob feel it.
Might a few. Show them the rod.
The Nazarene, is he dead yet?
After only 6 hours.
He can't be.
Has he spoken? Has he spoken?
Just before the tremor. He said it's finished.
See that it is.
All right, good. Another fantastic clip from the film.
Great.
Very, very cool. Thank you for showing these clips to us before the film even comes out.
Oh, it's my pleasure. We're excited to share this with you, especially since you've already seen the movie.
I have. I mean,
I'm glad everyone gets a chance to take a look at these clips.
Yeah, give them a little sneak peek. Yeah. I love it. Is this story personal for you in any way? The story of Jesus, the life of Christ. What is your journey in all of this as well? I'd just love to hear a little bit from you.
Sure. You know, I grew up in a Christian home. I accepted Christ at a youth group retreat.
Really?
Yeah, when I was 12 years old. And, you know,
I love it.
I'm one of those.
It's great. I just think of all the youth workers out there going, I don't know if that kid's going to turn out, but I'm going to love him to Jesus.
Someone did that for you.
That's great.
I was what some people call a triple dipper, right? So I was baptized. So some people, you know, I was baptized in church. Then, of course, I accepted Christ as like a 6-year-old.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, by the time I'm 11 or 12, no memory whatsoever of that.
Right.
And 12 years old, I really, you know, the third time was a charm. Really stuck.
I love it.
Know?
Just like Chili's, the triple
That's
dipper.
Right.
It's
That's
good.
Right.
Getting hungry now that you
so,
say that.
Yeah.
How awesome.
So, you know, I had parents that just really encouraged me. I was fortunate and blessed to grow up in a functional family.
Yeah.
You know, with a couple sisters. And I grew up really wanting to get into music and Christian music. I was a huge fan of Christian music growing up. And I was in a high school band, and we were kind of the go-to band for all the high school parties. And I wanted to get into music, and fortunately, one of the things that God revealed to me was that I wasn't very good.
So what a blessing that was.
It was actually, it was because I realized it early on, so I didn't end up, you know, playing at a Holiday Inn when I was 30 years old, right?
Yes.
I realized that I was good, but I really wasn't that good. I wasn't like by your record good.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but what I love to do is I love to tell people about new music. And so I ended up getting into kind of like marketing and promotion for Christian music. And I kind of grew up within a label called Sparrow Records,
yeah,
and
of course.
EMI Christian Music Group.
Yeah.
I became the president of that company, was there for 15 years and worked and developed artists like Toby Mac and Chris Tomlin and Switchfoot and all these incredible artists.
Holy smoke, you just listed them all right there. There you go.
David Crowder, Stephen Curtis Chapman.
I wish you could drop that mic, but it's attached to something. That's, yeah.
So, you know, I was there for many years and was the president, was there for 15 years. And by the time I'd had several girls, several daughters, my wife and I, and I started to realize that they were much more engaged in audiovisual content versus music.
Yep.
And there wasn't a whole lot for them to watch, a lot of great movies. And so I thought, you know, I want to get into this, like this space.
Awesome. Yep.
So I really set out to pursue getting into filmed entertainment and ended up at Sony Pictures. Starting Affirm Films and developing and producing, you know, faith-based and inspirational films, which,
awesome.
Which, you know, impact lives. And one of the first movies I wanted to get involved with was Soul Surfer. Again, one of the reasons why was because my daughters love Bethany Hamilton
That's
and her
awesome.
Story.
What an amazing story. So, for those of you that don't know, Soul Surfer is about a surfer, Bethany Hamilton, lost her arm in a shark attack.
That's right.
Amazing story. Again, beautiful, wonderful film.
Yeah.
That was the first one that Affirm
that was the first
under your
we had done we had done Fireproof and Facing the Giants, but it was the first movie where we went out and developed the script and secured the rights and hired the director and produced the film. So.
So awesome. Well, it was actually really forward thinking of you to see the music industry, and especially in the Christian side of things, established, flourishing, doing well, and a huge opportunity for not just for money to be made and all that, of course, but for the message of the gospel to be shared through this medium that had been largely ignored or pitiful little attempts of so many Christian films.
Sure.
This is big budget, high dollar, awesome movie making.
It is
that we see.
It is, and the passion kind of inspired me. And that was right around the time I was wrapping up my time at the EMI Christian Music Group. And I wanted to get into filmed entertainment, and that was like the first big faith-based film of the modern era.
Yeah.
But it was kind of a story of Jesus Christ, central to our faith. And I really wanted to also do something that was contemporary, you know, contemporary dramas and family films and things like that. So that was part of my inspiration to go after film.
Yeah,
so.
I love it that you can tell modern stories as well as these classic stories, like Risen, obviously the biblical text coming to life.
Yeah,
I love it. Well, your story is incredible, and it's fun to see the hard work has paid off in a great film like this.
And I must say that... you know, in that youth retreat, it was at River Valley Ranch in Millers, Maryland, when I was 12 years old.
Wow.
And the youth group leaders that were part of our life in that little youth group were life-changing for me. So
that's awesome.
I just want to encourage any of you guys that are working with youth. It really makes a difference.
Well, and that is one of the very best things about what we get to do at Download Youth Ministries. We're equipping and serving these amazing men and women. Most of them volunteer.
Mm.
A few paid and some professional, all that. But they just love God and love students. And it's so fun to see you years later.
Yeah, many years.
Many years later. But reaping the faithfulness of those people that poured into your life.
It's great.
It's beautiful. Let's watch another clip from the movie Risen.
Salve, prefect.
You smell of meat. A feast?
Funeral.
There's your solution. Burn him in public.
God forbids cremation.
He also forbids labor on the Sabbath, and yet here you are.
Tribune.
Burn him.
The crucified Nazarene.
Why? His business unfinished.
The man's dead, Caiaphas. His followers are in hiding. He's no longer a threat to your monopoly on piety.
But still a threat, Prefect.
While alive, that deceiver said he would rise again after 3 days. He foretold it. We request that the sepulcher be sealed, lest his disciples come in the night, steal the body, and say that he is risen from death. That would cause more unrest in this city than all his blasphemies combined.
You have your own guard. Secure it yourself.
My words exactly.
To which I replied, we need a Roman seal. This must be seen as the impartial will of the prefect.
And not yours.
We seek only what Caesar seeks. Peace in Jerusalem, peace in Judea, which you will lose if this body vanishes.
Ends my summoning.
Just see to it.
Satisfy yourself.
Seal it.
Seal.
All right, good. Another clip from the movie Risen. Great. Obviously, people can see that this was filmed all over the world, amazing locations, but you've also got some incredible talent on screen, too. Yes. How did you get A-list actors? Joe Fiennes, Tom Felton, how did you get this caliber of actors on screen?
Well, it really was a combination of our director, Kevin Reynolds, and our producers, Mickey Liddell and Pete Schilleman. One of the things, a lot of people think about directors as bringing a vision for the picture. But what a lot of people don't understand is that directors also bring a reputation.
Oh, absolutely.
That either attracts or repels actors. So sometimes you have a piece of work that an actor is ambivalent about doing, but when they find out that a certain director is on it,
yeah,
you may get that actor.
That's
so
awesome.
Kevin played a role in getting Joe on, as well as our producers, and Joseph Fiennes was the first land the first actor that we landed, and then for his aide Lucius, there were a couple different actors we were looking at, but we wanted this. Joe is kind of an olive-skinned, dark-haired, and we wanted kind of a northern Italian, northern Roman-looking, and Tom Felton was very high on a couple of our producers' lists.
Oh, absolutely.
And Tom jumped at it because this is one of the first big kind of dramatic role opportunities for him.
Well, and he's been in some amazing films.
Yeah, I mean, Harry Potter.
Harry
Potter
is all you need to say. I mean, he's unbelievable.
He's Lucius and Risen, but his father was Lucius and Harry Potter, so.
I love it. Well, it's actually cool. At the screening of the film, I got to meet Tom. We had the most amazing, I call him Tom because we're just on a first name basis
of course,
now.
Yeah.
We do talk occasionally now, just as a we don't. But anyhow, I got to meet him and have a conversation about how his character in the film, again, I won't spoil it for you, but he's on a spiritual journey.
Yeah.
And how even Tom in his personal life is also echoing that spiritual journey, and certainly raised with some faith, but now in Hollywood in his life. It was a wonderful conversation and a really cool parallel to what you see him as he performs on screen too. Was there a standout performance? Was there a particular, I know we've already talked about your favorite scene, but is there who rises to the top in this film?
Well, I mean, I think they all did an incredible job. I mean, Joseph Fiennes, who some people would know from the Academy Award winning Shakespeare in Love.
Oh, absolutely.
Joseph, he went to gladiator school in Rome for several weeks.
Wow.
To learn how to be a gladiator. He had a pretty wide range of performance, from being a military leader in battle, to being an interrogator, to being in a man who is passionate about finding the truth and seeking peace, and he's really just tired of the life he's lived.
Yep.
You know, Tom Felton's performance really is kind of a breakout from his kind of younger characters he played.
Sure.
And just playing that lead who has to have he has a pretty important arc in that, you know, without spoiling it, there's a critical point at which point he's very loyal to Rome. He's loyal to his superior, which is Clavius, the Roman tribune. But there's a point at which Clavius and Lucius come to blows, essentially.
Right.
And you know, Tom's performance there when he has to kind of turn against his superior is very powerful. We also had Cliff Curtis, who plays Yeshua, Jesus.
Yes.
Some people might know Cliff. I'm sure maybe you don't watch this show, but there's a little show on TV called Fear the Walking Dead. and Cliff Curtis is in Fear the Walking Dead. He's kind of a dark horse Academy Award potential with another movie he's done.
Yes.
Incredible performance. And he took a several-month vow of silence when he landed the role as Jesus, just to prepare himself spiritually and physically. When you go see the movie, there's a scene near the very end, okay? And you'll know what it is. There's a scene where when Yeshua speaks, when Cliff speaks, it's the first time that several of the actors have ever heard him speak, because we shot that scene first.
What?
So it's on the rock, right? It's on the rock in the dark.
Oh, that's cool.
And it's the first time those actors that were in that scene heard him speak.
Because he's had this vow of silence. He was in this vow of silence
even through rehearsals.
No.
And he would always communicate with a pad. He had a pad and pencil. So even when they all went to dinner after they shot, you know, he would be writing on a pad.
That is some serious, was that method acting?
It is.
You are in the zone.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing.
How cool. Yeah. Well, we'll definitely look out for that scene. Incredible. Great. Well, I got a couple last questions for you, but let's just pull ahead and watch one last clip from the movie Risen.
He's gone.
The Nazarene.
Of course the Nazarene. His tomb is stone empty.
Who brought this news? The guards?
Your guards are missing. Some simpleton reported it. Who did you put on the detail? I want them found and lashed to death, preferably.
Let me investigate.
Well, that will be helpful before Caiaphas and his pack of raving Jews show up here.
Too late. Tribune. Shall we dispense with lies? The guards have told me.
They came to you?
Seeking sanctuary. They know the penalty for sleeping on duty.
What happened?
Exactly as I had predicted. The heretic's disciples came in the night and stole the body. Already they are proclaiming him risen from death.
Will the people believe it?
The weak will. Others want to. So we must announce the theft.
Will they believe you?
They'll believe the guards. If you don't kill them first.
Endless.
Proclaim it before this blossoms.
It's not enough. Without a corpse to prove him dead, we have a potential messiah. I want no doubt. Tiberius cannot arrive to unrest. We must find a body. Will you help?
Of course. But proclaim it.
Was my confidence in you misplaced, Tribune? Perhaps you'd prefer a post in hell. You will track down each and every one of these disciples, but more importantly, you will find the corpse of this cursed Yeshua before it rots.
All right, great. Another clip from the film. Again, thank you for sharing this with us. Let's kind of pull it all together here. Tell me about filming this bad boy. Obviously, you traveled all over the world, amazing actors. What obstacles did you encounter as this unfolded?
Well, the biggest obstacle was seeing this picture not get made for 7 years.
Wow.
So when we first started Affirm Films in 2007, one of the things we wanted to do is we wanted to look at telling the rest of the story from the Passion of the Christ perspective, right?
Sure.
What happened after?
Yeah, so he dies. Right. Now what? Right. Yeah. And how about he comes back to life and there's a lot more to tell?
That's right. There were actually several producers and several people that had the same idea. And we looked at maybe 10 or 12 different scripts from 10 or 12 different producing groups. And of the multiple scripts that we read, this was by far our favorite one. And we could not make a deal work on this picture.
Wait, this is 2007.
This is 2007.
This has been around for a while then.
So we could not make a deal. It just kind of died off. And that was the end of that. I mean, it just disappeared.
And you found success with other movies and other genres. And so
we were off to something else. And,
no way.
And the whole idea of, you know, as each year progressed, as we got farther and farther away from Passion, there was less heat on the idea of continuing the story. Just kind of, you know. So in 2014, I had a conversation with Mickey Liddell from LD Entertainment, who's the producer. And he said, hey, look, we really want to tell the story of Jesus, but from a different perspective. We got the script we want to shoot, and we'd love to partner with you.
Wow.
I said, yeah, sure, you know, send the script. But I had actually just recently told someone, you know, I had no desire to do robe and sandal movies, right?
Like,
no,
yeah, we're done with
that.
Because
I could just picture the same, hey, let's tell the story of the Gospel of Mark or Luke.
Right.
Or let's, and I just feel like it's not that I don't love those stories, it's just that other people have done them really well. So why do it again?
Absolutely.
So he sent the script. I read it at how I remember. I was sitting on the couch, and I read the first page, and I thought, this is the script that I loved 7 years ago.
No way.
So called Mickey up the next day. I said, we're in. We're in.
Awesome.
I mean, the reason I love this story is because it's from Clavius's point of view. It's so. Here's what I love most about this movie. Okay.
Yeah.
Of all the movies we've done at Affirm Films, when we test them, in front of consumers. We do two kinds of tests. We do tests where we recruit people that we know are Christians. And then we recruit people that are just general population, which Christians show up in because we're in the general population.
Absolutely,
right?
Yeah.
But, you know, they're very different audiences because one we're recruiting at Bible studies and youth groups and churches. The other one we're recruiting at malls and whatever, at theaters. So of all the movies we've done, when we test it, one of the questions we ask the audience is there, you know, do you feel like you're being preached to? Is there too much faith in this, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So... those numbers tend to be really high in the general audience tests.
Yeah, because they'd be very sensitive to that. They'd be like, yes, it was everywhere.
Yeah, it was like,
I felt it was,
you know, they were slapping me over the head with a Bible, right?
Sure.
So we would often see numbers where, you know, 30 or 40 or 50 or 60% of the people said. So we tested Risen, and the number was like 13%.
No way.
And the reason why is that Pastor Rick White actually said it best. He said, it's the least threatening, most approachable story about Jesus Christ.
I love it.
Because it's from the eyes of someone who doesn't even believe the Messiah exists.
Yeah, literally a skeptic at
best. Skeptic, right?
Yeah.
So you're entering and you're moving through the story from a skeptic's point of view, and so it's very non-threatening. And people who are not churched, who are not believers, don't feel threatened, and they can go for the ride, and they can experience what Clavius experiences.
That's awesome.
And then Christians who know and love the story well love it because it's like this this fresh water pouring over you where you're like, okay, I've known this story for 10 or 20 or 30 years. But this is a whole different way to experience it.
Oh, absolutely.
So that's, I think, the magic, so to speak.
Now that you say that, of course, having seen the film, I'm starting to feel that same way, going, yes, this character mirrors this type of person in today's world.
Right.
This character, a little different angle, mirrors someone from today. Even the devout Christian that you mentioned, they're in the film, maybe not as the forefront or whatever, but they're certainly there.
Yes.
And you're going, that's me. I would be right
there.
Right.
That's
all the way from skeptics to people who believe that he was their savior.
Yes.
And I think you're right. That's a really, really powerful
I love that about the
expression.
Movie.
How cool. Yeah. Very neat. Well, obviously, we're talking to youth workers. A lot of youth workers out there have the potential to take students to this, to share the message of Jesus and the gospel of Christ. And so how do we get behind this film? When is it coming out? I think it was January originally,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it was now, January. We moved it to February 19th. We wanted to get a little closer to Easter.
Absolutely.
And I would just say this to youth leaders, youth pastors, those who engage with youth. You know, this movie is a presentation of the life of Christ, and the gospel is very clear, but it's in such a kind of as I said, non-threatening, mm-hmm. almost sneaky way. It just kind like of it shows up, right? And I can assure you, the best I can assure you, that the quality of the cinematography and the performances, there is the last thing you will hear someone say about this is that it has cheesy Christian movie DNA. It does not.
Yep. Well, and your first gut instinct would be like, this is not, more of the same. And it is not more of the same.
It's not. It's things like Passion of the Christ and Son of God and the Nativity. And
certainly. They change the game.
Yeah, they're beautiful stories, and they're kind of beat for beat scriptural recreations, right?
And Jesus looks like you'd expect him to look. And the water and the Galilee, everything is just as you would expect, right?
And this is not, gritty, dirty, these people are out to crush the growing church. They're out to crush those who say that this guy Jesus rose again.
Yeah.
And
crush the rebellion that eventually becomes the church that we are a part of now, to this day, thousands of years later, here we are. And you see the formation of it in those disciples, those devoted followers, and the journey from skeptic to devoted follower too.
And I think the kids of the youth will love it because there's a manhunt segment, there's a thrilling battle segment, and it's something that church kids can feel very confident about pulling in unchurched kids too. A lot of outreach potential.
I absolutely agree with that. Having seen it, I could not agree more. I hope that youth workers get behind it. I know we are. We're excited for the film to come out. And honestly, thrilled that you're here today sharing this message and the dreams that you have for the film. It sounds like there were a lot of obstacles to getting it made.
Yes.
And so we're thankful that, first of all, for what you do, and we're thankful for a film that we can invite our friends to share Jesus with.
In February 19th. All right. February 19th is a release date. And what's cool is Sony Pictures can work with churches and youth groups where you can actually open the movie 1, 2, or even 3 days early.
Really? That's cool.
If you book a theater.
Yeah.
So I just found out today in a meeting that even Tuesday night of opening week. So if you have like youth group meetings or Bible studies on Tuesdays or Wednesdays, you can actually book the theater and be the first in the country to watch the movie.
That's really fun. Yeah. So many of the youth ministries of people that will be listening, they are Wednesday night youth group. Great. So you could say, hey, at youth, we're meeting at the movie theater tonight.
That's
for
right.
a youth group.
That's
Bring right. your friends.
Open the movie. Be the first in your town to see the movie.
That's really cool. Well, thank you very much. We will go see the film, and thanks for giving us a little insight into it today. Any little hint as to what's next from you or from Affirm?
Sure.
What's next?
We have another movie coming out March 18th, so a month later. We've been busy bees. So we have another movie called Miracles from Heaven, which stars Jennifer Garner and Queen Latifah.
Terrific.
And it is a true story. It's from the same producers that we worked on with Heaven is for Real.
Yeah.
So whereas Heaven is for Real was kind of a heavenly story of a father and son, Miracles from Heaven is an earthly story of a healing with a mother and daughter.
Right.
So it's a beautiful story. And then we are, in fact, I have dinner tonight with an incredible director named Randall Wallace,
awesome.
Who did Braveheart. He wrote Braveheart. He did We Were Soldiers. He did Secretariat.
When do we leave for dinner? I can't wait to go. Wait, what?
But I'm having dinner with him and the producer, Mickey Liddell, that we worked on with Risen, to get the three of us on the same page to do this incredible movie I've been wanting to do for 10 years,
even before
I was at a firm.
And
we're getting close to knocking it. So we're...
I love the tease. You're not going to tell us the name of the film.
All right.
No, I love it.
Not.
Good for you.
Yeah.
Keep a little secret, a little mystery box right here in front. Well, thank you for your time today. And we're excited to support Risen. Thank you for creating this film. It's going to be a great, great time.
Thank you so much. I appreciate
it. All right. Go see the movie. See you guys.